हेलो गाइस, वेलकम टू यू टू द जर्नी ऑफ लिटरेचर. नाउ इट्स द वर्स्ट स्टॉक ऑन डैफोडिल्स बाय विलियम वॉर्ड्सवर्थ पार्ट वन. बिफोर वी अंडरस्टैंड द मीनिंग ऑफ दिस पोएम डैफोडिल्स, इट्स इम्पोर्टेंट टू नो सम इम्पोर्टेंट फैक्ट्स एंड सम इम्पोर्टेंट पॉइंट्स ऑन इट. द टाइम गोइंग टू प्रेजेंट. सो एट फर्स्ट इफ वी नोटिस द टाइटल ऑफ दिस पोएम, बिफोर डैफोडिल्स इट वॉज आई वंडर्ड लोनली एज ए क्लाउड. That published first time in 1807. The first title of the poem, I Wander Lonely as a Cloud, actually defines the complete sense of the poem as a loneliness and sadness types, you know. So in this point, when we come to the poem, it's actually Wordsworth give more priority on the flower daffodils. So where we talk about a flower that symbolized actually terms like happiness and fresh positive things also. That's why some scholars thought that to change the name as daffodils. Francis Palgrin was one of the scholars among them who suggest also the title as the daffodils in his works and collection of some poems, The Golden Tragedy, got published in 1875. So now my point about the poet William Wordsworth. The poem Daffodils was composed by William Wordsworth and got published in 1807. It was actually the first time publication. As we all know that William Wordsworth as a romantic poet. Romantic never take it in the another sense. Romantic in the sense, I mean, actually see the actual beauty is in every small things that provide a heartly pleasures to us. So exactly in this sense, William Wordsworth was one of the most prolific poet who was romantic for nature. I mean, he saw the natural beauty and the actual beauty in nature, by which he called himself a nature poet, as we all know that. So William Wordsworth, one of the most beloved poet and the amazing product for literature of all times during the late 17th century and 18th century, a time known in literature as a romantic period. Romantic era actually started by William Wordsworth, who was honored as England's poet laureate and launched the English romantic movement along with Samuel Taylor Coleridge. As we all know that the lyrical ballad by Wordsworth and Coleridge, 1798, was a famous work in literature. After this, in literature, the complete scenery of English poetry was actually changed, completely changed here. And the special quality in Wordsworth, always he used the common words and the common language to express his feelings. Now my point is about the poem. The idea of the poem Daffodils was actually came to the mind of Wordsworth in 15th April 1802 when he visited with his sister Dorothy, and in 1804 to 1807 during this period Wordsworth wrote it and named as I Wandered Lonely as a Cloud first time. This is actually a lyric poem got published in 1807 for first time, and in second time revised version of this poem was published 1815. During the first publication, the poems actually consist three stanzas, and in the second time it consists four stanzas. The second stanza newly added here in the second time publication. So if we notice the form of this poem Daffodils has a fairly simple form and consists of four stanzas with six lines each, for a total of 24 lines here in the poem. And the rhyme scheme of this poem is A, B, A, B, C, C. So the poem contains four stanzas of six lines each called sestets, and in each stanza ending with a rhyming couplet. The rhyming couplet is C, C. So now the meter that used in this poem is iambic tetrameter. Iambic tetrameter means each line has four tetra iams. I mean a short syllable followed by a longer syllable, and in other word, an unstressed syllable that followed by stressed syllable. Let me explain how is iambic tetrameter. So take the line, the first line of the poem is I wandered lonely as a cloud. So I is a unstressed syllable, and one, W-A-N, one is stressed here, and D-E-R-E-D, dirt is unstressed here, and then lawn, L-O-N-E, lawn is stressed here, and L-Y-L-E is unstressed, and then edge, A-S, edge is stressed, and A is unstressed, and cloud is stressed here. So in which sentence the unstressed followed to stressed, unstressed stressed, unstressed stressed, like this is called iambic tetrameter. So now the question is, why it's called tetrameter? Tetra means four. If we have 5 meters, then it's called pentameter, but here we have four unstressed syllable and four stressed syllable, so we have 4 meter, so it's called tetrameter. So the meter that used here in the poem is called iambic tetrameter. So now the point is figure of speech. How much figure of speech used here in this poem? 5 types of figure of speech that used here in this poem. Number 1, simile. Number 2, metaphor. Number 3, alliteration. Number 4, hyperbole. Number 5, personification. Let's see what is this actually. Number 1, simile. Simile means comparison between two different things. When we compare between two different things by using the terms like as and like, it's called simile. Example, he looked like as a cat. Actually he's not, but we compare him as a cat, with a cat, I mean. So this is simile. And number 2, metaphor, an implied simile. I mean, when we directly use the term for something or someone in the sense it may be or may not be, it's called metaphor. Example, he is a tiger. So the term tiger, a animal's name that we directly use for him. He is not actually a tiger, but we use directly for him and take him as a tiger. So in simile, we compare him with a cat, look like as. So it's called simile. And in metaphor, we directly use the term for something or someone. It may be in the sense or may not be. So it's called metaphor. The third figure of speech that used here in the poem is alliteration. Means having the same first consonant sound. Some examples of alliteration is Tim took tons of tools to make toys for toads. Tim took tons, tools, toys and toads. All these words sounds as the same consonant. Like this, Nitu's nephew needed some notebooks. 6 students slept soundly on the sand. This all the words sounds like the same consonant. So it's called alliteration. And the number 4th figure of speech that used here, hyperbole. To exaggerate our terms, words, sounds, what we use is called hyperbole. So much exaggerated. So let me take some example in daffodils here. 10,000 saw I at a glance. 10,000, is it possible to saw at a glance 10,000 of daffodils? No, but Wordsworth here to exaggerate his lines used the terms just like 10,000. So it's called hyperbole. The last one is personifications. Means when an animal, bird, idea or any objects is seen in a human terms is called personification. Let me explain by the lines of this poem that when all at once I saw a crowd, the term crowd, particular word, is used for person, but here daffodils personified as a person by Wordsworth, so it's called personifications. And a host of golden daffodils. host that the particular term is used for group of persons, but here words were to personify daffodils used a host of golden daffodils, so it's personifications. And another example, fluttering and dancing in the breeze, which is the last line of the first stanza. So the word dancing is used for the person, but here daffodils personified by the word dancing, so it's called personification. Exactly in the second stanza's last line, tossing their heads in sprightly dance. So here also daffodils personified by the words like dance. So it's called personification. So this is all about the important facts and also the important points on daffodils. Apart from this talk, I will try to understand the meaning of this poetry in my next part of talk. The Daffodils by William Wordsworth, part 2. So hope the first part of my talk is helpful and useful for you. If you have any objection, please drop your voice in the comment section, and God bless you. Thank you.